My name is Andrea Gruber. I work at SINTEF, and I will present some fundamental findings related to hydrogen combustion that we discovered here. And then Andrea will provide a more applied presentation of the actual gas turbine results in this matter. So, so as announced, I will provide some fundamental insights and then some more applied findings by Andrea. So first of all, I would like to acknowledge some people that contributed to the scientific work, Jackie Chen and Martin Riet of Sandia, former Williams at UCSD, Professor James Dawson and Sam Weissman of NTNU, Nicolas Noiret of ETH, and also, of course, the sponsors, so the NCCS Center and Ansaldo Energia, but also the Big H2 Consortium, who enabled some of these results that I will present today, so Climit, Gasnova, Siemens Energy, and Equinor. So I will cut short the initial blah blah, I would say. In a low carbon future, hydrogen and ammonia are seen as convenient carbon-free energy carriers. This talk is about hydrogen and using gas turbines. Of course, hydrogen can also be used in the separating engines and in fuel cells, but this talk will focus on gas turbines. On my side, from combustion research point of view, our goal is the implementation of clean and efficient fuel flexible power generation and propulsion devices. So what is combustion and gas turbine? Well, the Brayton cycles that represent the gas turbine is actually independent of the fuel that is burned in the gas turbine, even though gas turbines have been associated with fossil fuels, so natural gas, oil, and so on. But the Q in, so the thermal, the heat input in the cycle, comes from combustion of any fuel. And so it can be, of course, combustion of hydrogen, ammonia, or other fuels. You see here one of the Ansaldo gas turbines and the combustor inside it. In gas turbines, the flame is burning continuously, and therefore one important point and one important challenge, I would say the main one, is flame stabilization. Also important are emissions, of course, and limiting harmful emissions. But of course, if there is no flame stabilization, there is no gas turbine. So they are listed there in order of importance. And today's talk will focus on the first one, so flame stabilization. So what is flame stabilization is, of course, dependent on the combustion characteristics of the fuels. And in this slide, I just summarize some of the combustion characteristics of very different fuels. So natural gas as a representative of fossil fuel, hydrogen, ammonia. And you see, long story short, is that there are order of magnitude differences here that have to be taken into account. But today's topic is hydrogen, and regarding hydrogen, crucially, the light hydrogen molecule diffuses very fast, and it's therefore characterized by a Lewis number lower than unity. So the Lewis number represents the ratio of the thermal and mass diffusivity, and we will come back to why this is important. Now I will go and introduce you to four fundamental concepts that are needed to understand the rest of the presentation, and I hope you can bear with me through this quick introduction to combustion concepts. So the first one is the propagation stabilized flames, so in which there is a thin propagating flame front that is located at a position, and this position is determined by the balance between the reactant flow, the unburned reactant flow coming from the left, in this case at bulk velocity, U bulk, and the deflagration front speed, VT, that I indicate here as VT. This balance actually controls the flare stabilization in gas turbines and elsewhere. In this case, the flame is propagating. So it's the balance represents actually the ability of the flame to propagate at the same velocity at which the reactants come from the left-hand side. Then auto-ignition stabilization is completely different. Here, the reactants are at such a high unburned temperature that they would ignite after mixing, after some ignition time, independently of the flow condition. So this auto-ignition stabilization actually allows arbitrary flow velocities, and the mixture then would explode after time that is normally called the ignition delay time. And therefore does not represent a balance between a propagation of the deflagration front with the flow, but really represent a function of the inlet reactant temperature, because the inlet reactant temperature determines the ignition delay time, and so the time at which the mixture explodes or ignites. So these are two very different ways of stabilizing flame in a gas turbine, and both me and Andrea will come back to that later. Also, a second concept is the turbulent burning rate. This is a picture from Forman Williams' book that tries to summarize this concept. So you have turbulent flow of reactants coming from the left and burn products on the right, and then you have a turbulent flame sheet that is indicated with AF. And here a theory first proposed by Gerhard Damkohler in 1940 hypothesized that the turbulent burning rate, so VT, and its ratio with the laminar burning velocity of the flame is proportional to the ratio between the area of the flame, so AF, the wrinkled flame has an area AF, and its projection A. So this is the Damkohler hypothesis, and in this hypothesis, finally, you can express the turbulent burning rate as a function of the laminar one plus an algebraic expression that contains the fluctuating turbulent velocity and a turbulent length scale LT. So in this case, then you can say that you are using an algebraic expression containing U prime and LT as a mean to find the ratio between the wrinkled flame area and the projected one. This eventually leads to the conventional way of representing a turbulent burning velocity, as I show in this plot from Karpov and Severin, where the turbulent burning velocity is actually related to the, for example, turbulent velocity, U prime. And as you see, there is a very clear correlation between the intensity of the turbulence, so U prime, and the combustion velocity. This is the conventional way of expressing the turbulent burn velocity. In conclusion, one could say that Damkohler's hypothesis means that the turbulent burning rate is mainly controlled by the flame surface area generation, and that means by U prime and LT. This has led over the years to the development of many models, semi-empirical models, that try to estimate the turbulent burning rate, so in this case UT in this formula, by the turbulent quantities and by the laminar flame speed. So I give this as an example. The third concept regards flame instabilities. And the first type of flame instability is the hydrodynamic or the Riemann-Landau instability. The most important one for today is the thermodiffusive instability. And this instability, unlike the hydrodynamic instability, only characterizes fuels which have a Lewis number different from one. And I will come back to more details about that. So the big difference here is that while hydrodynamic instabilities are present in all flames, and they play a relatively minor role, I would say. Thermodiffusive instabilities characterize, for example, hydrogen flame for today's topic, and can become very, very important, as we will see. This thermodiffusive unstable mechanism was first proposed by Zeldovich in the 40s. A third instability is that related to pressure-temperature coupling for autoignitive mixtures. This is an important instability. However, today is not relevant for the content of our presentation. So I will skip that. So the fourth and last concept regards the stretch factor, that is a way to quantify the thermodiffusive instability. So this is the formula representing this. So the stretch factor I naught represent the ratio between the overall burning rate, so SC in this formula that I called VT in the previous slides, that is normalized by the sigma, so the flame surface area ratio that I previously indicated as F by A, and SL, which is the nominal laminar flame speed. So this stretch factor basically quantifies the thermodiffusive instability for the following reason. It relates the actual burning rate to the burning rate that a flame who's locally propagating at the laminar flame speed would have had. And you can see here on the right-hand side what hydrogen does to flames and the relation to the Lewis number. The fact that you have a curvature, a curved flame bulge in this case, and the hot condition in this point, does that hydrogen focuses on this point, and the heat loss from the flame to the surrounding is actually lower than the apport of hydrogen due to diffusion. This is because, as we saw before, heat diffuses slower than hydrogen into the flame. And this is the key here. Hydrogen is fundamentally different for all other fuels because of this, and leads to local enrichment, so higher equivalence ratio at these points, and therefore accelerate this point, which increases curvature, increases the hydrogen focusing, and so on. This is visible in this graph provided by Hong-Kim that illustrates the normalized burning rate as opposed to the area ratio. And you see that for hydrogen, there is a difference between these two lines, while for a conventional fuel, that in this case is ammonia, but it could have been natural gas, the two lines are on top of each other. So in this case, I naught would be one. In this case, I naught would be larger than one. So in other words, I naught larger than one represents the turbulent burning rate departure from the conventional behavior that natural gas or, for example, ammonia would have. And the conventional behavior is where the burning rate is only proportional to the air ratio, to the area ratio. So hydrogen is different, fundamentally different. A conventional assumption, though, has been that molecular transport phenomena are typically overwhelmed by turbulent transport at high Reynolds number. And as we will see, and this is the novelty of this, this is not true really for hydrogen flames. The experiment that I will show now was conducted in the Big H2 project and was a blowout experiment. So in a bluff body stabilized burner, a hydrogen ammonia flame was compared to a methane flame for identical laminar flame properties. And the experiments reported to our great surprise, an order of magnitude difference in the blowout velocity. So for identical equivalence ratio, the A1 flame was blown out, so the ammonia hydrogen flame was blown out at 120 meters per second, while the methane flame at 12. And the only difference between these two flames is hydrogen diffusion, because as you see from the graphs on the top, the both adiabatic flame temperature, the laminar flame speed, and the flame thickness are identical for these two mixtures. So this is the proof that nominally identical flame from the laminar point of view behave very differently when thermodiffusion instabilities kick in. And this also means that molecular diffusion plays an important role even in highly turbulent flames as this one. And this is, I would say, a new finding that contradicts conventional assumptions. Then we also did some direct numerical simulation studies. So first principle numerical simulations that in this case compare to flame that should be identical to all effect except for the pressure. And we have observed an important effect of pressure on the thermodiffusive instabilities. So on the right hand side, you see the red, intensely red colored parts of the flame. This is a 10 bar signifying this locally enriched curved flame regions that accelerate the flame. This happens at 10 atmosphere, it doesn't happen at 1 atmosphere. So this suggested to us that the pressure also affects flame instabilities and the local enrichment and the flame acceleration. Then looked at the literature and the work of the group at Heinz Beach in Aachen. We also observed that the effect of higher equivalence ratios is important in respect to I-naught. And of course, going to higher equivalence ratios, what you do is that you move the flame along this curve. And that means that the local enrichment doesn't accelerate the flame so much because you are closer to the peak. So going to lean condition implies further acceleration of the flame. Also, high reactant temperature leads to weaker thermodiffusive instabilities and relatively slower flame. This is due to the fact that the temperature difference impacts the diffusion of hydrogen into the leading points and therefore has an impact on I-naught. Also pressure, as I showed in the previous slide, impact the thermodiffusive instabilities and leads to higher I-naught. So in the end, our aim was, can we find a single governing parameter that represent this observation? And we did this using 3D direct numerical simulation for turbulent conditions and investigating very many different pressure and reactant temperature and equivalence ratios condition. And finally, we came up with the scaling based on a Zeldovich and Pekele number that are able to parameterize I-naught in the way I show here. So basically, the departure from the conventional behavior of natural gas is illustrated by this curve. And you see an I-naught of 6 means very strongly accelerated flame. This parameterization is based on a Zeldovich and Pekele number that respectively represent the flame reactivity and the flame tendency to become thermodiffusive and unstable. And what this scaling tells us is that as reactant pressure is increased, this leads to higher, everything else being equal, this leads to higher acceleration of the flame and flame instability. As the reactant temperature is increased, this leads to the opposite effect, so to a lower value I-naught. As reactant temperature is decreased instead, everything else being equal, this leads to a higher I naught. So one can say from this fact that propagating flame, hydrogen propagating flame, tend to become much more unstable, while auto-igniting flame are less unstable. In other words, nominally weaker flames exhibit a stronger potential to accelerate. The proof of the pudding is in the experiments, and we are also looking at experimental data that actually confirm the scaling, and this is really a work in progress. As a summary, then, giving the word to Andrea, I can just comment that in propagation stabilized frame are strongly rate controlled by thermodiffusion instabilities and hydrogen diffusion at the leading points of the flame, and this effect is increased by pressure. The practical implication in gas turbine is that in conventional single stage combustion systems, flame stabilization challenges increase with pressure and flame temperature. However, at auto-ignition stabilized flame that have a higher temperature because they have to lead to auto-ignition, there is a weaker effect of diffusion at the leading points and the stronger role of the diffusion of the H radical at the trailing points. And this has a stabilizing effect on the flame front that becomes more flat, therefore, and a weaker pressure impact. The practical implication is that flame stability issues are greatly mitigated in reheat and sequential systems. And this, I think, it's a good introduction for what Andrea will show us in his slides. So thank you for the moment, and we'll talk later during the Q&A session.
So good afternoon, everybody, also from my side, and thanks again for this nice introduction, and thanks for joining the second part of this webinar. And here we'll go through an overview of the sequential combustion systems used in heavy duty gas turbines and their flexibility, so enabling large amounts of hydrogen to be used for low CO2 power generation. The presentation, it will be structured in this manner. After a short introduction about the gas turbine potential to reduce CO2 emissions, which we already partly saw in Andrea's introduction, we will look into the basic principle of a sequential combustion system and its intrinsic fuel flexibility, enabling hydrogen-based fuels to be used in power generation and industrial application. So, starting with maybe the CO2 footprint. Just a second, there is still something wrong with the preview here. And one, yeah. So as we see in the chart on the left, gas turbines are already offering a drastic reduction of CO2 emission per unit power generated in comparison with coal power plants, as shown in this reference bar chart. So even a single cycle machine is already producing power with roughly half the CO2 compared with coal. Thanks to the higher efficiency, combined cycle are mostly used in combination with large-scale gas turbines, and due to this, the CO2 emissions go farther down. Still, to get to net zero, decarbonization of gas turbine is crucial, and this can be achieved by substituting part and ultimately all the natural gas with hydrogen, bringing the CO2 footprint close to zero, as shown here. In the chart on the right here, we can better see the impact of using hydrogen on CO2 abatement, shown by the blue line. So this percentage is the percentage CO2 abatement when increasing the amount of hydrogen in natural gas on the x-axis. And with the green line, we see the absolute value in terms of gram CO2 per kilowatt hour produced. And we see that to get to really major reduction, it's necessary to go to high hydrogen values in the fuel, in particular, if we want to achieve this mid-long term target of being below 100 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour, we need to get to at least 90% hydrogen in the fuel. So let's now introduce the GT36 machine, particularly interesting today also because of its unique sequential combustion system. In combined cycle, it can generate up to 800 megawatts, thus offering the potential to decarbonize roughly 500,000 households. The combustor is composed by 16 cans, so 16 can combustors all around the engine, pullable with a closed engine for easier serviceability and also upgradability. So the remainder of the presentation will focus on the sequential combustor cans. So the layout of such combustor is shown here. So, and it mainly consists of two combustion chambers in series. On the top left here, the so-called multi-burner first stage stabilizes a flame-by-flame propagation. So back to what Andrea was showing a few minutes ago. So this flame up here is a flame that is stabilized by propagating against the mixture of air and fuel that is traveling against the flame. While the second stage, so the second flame here, it's stabilized by self-ignition, also known auto-ignition or spontaneous ignition. So an ignition of the fuel-air mixture that happens spontaneously because of the high temperature that is present at the inlet of this burner. And we had already some introduction why these advantages, and now let's go further in detail about this. So if we make a simple schematic of this system, we can depict it in this way. So in the first stage, so in this flame here, it's represented down by this flame here. And in the first stage, we achieve a certain temperature level, this one, mainly targeting best flame stability at low emissions. So to generate the optimum conditions to trigger self-ignition in the second stage here. So this burner here. The self-ignition time of the fuel in the second stage is triggered by the temperature, so this level here, at the sequential burner inlet. And this self-ignition time defines, in particular, the position of the flame, so where the flame is located here in comparison from where the fuel is injected. Now, if we introduce now hydrogen instead of natural gas or a highly containing hydrogen fuel, the general issues would be, like in every system, that the flames, due to the higher activity of hydrogen, move toward the injectors, move into the mixing ducts, and this would be detrimental for the hardware, extremely detrimental for emissions, lifetime, and it's the so-called flashback. In a sequential system, though, this can be avoided by reducing the flame temperature in the first stage. So like shown in this simple schematic, if we go down with the temperature on the first stage, of course, we reduce dramatically the reactivity of this mixture in the first stage because it goes exponentially with the lower temperature. So the flame goes back at its design position on the first stage. And consequently, automatically, the second stage inlet temperature here, which defines this self-ignition, auto-ignition time, it's also reduced, therefore compensating the higher activity of the hydrogen. So this brings back the sequential burner flame as well to its design condition. And as far as self-ignition is driving the flame stability or the flame stabilization on the second stage, then the overall power of the machine, the overall flame temperature here, can be maintained by recovering with more fuel in the second stage what taken away from the first stage, than maintaining high power and efficiency of the engine. Now, to validate such a system being extremely large in the dimension, in particular in consumption of air and fuel, a massive infrastructure is needed and to reproduce fully the engine condition as shown in this chart here. So just a snapshot here about the required infrastructure to store liquid hydrogen here, then gasify inked it in these trailers here and provide several tons of hydrogen per day for a test, and also the challenging boundary conditions that are needed to be reproduced by the test cell with up to 70 kilograms of air per second streaming in it at high temperature and pressure. So a rig was built to fully reproduce engine condition for one can and the best transferability of the results from the single can to the full engine, as shown here. So we see the rig inside the test cell that was shown in the slide before. So, and you may recognize then a can that can be accommodated into this rig, which then reproduces also the turbine inlet condition, the compressor exit condition, and then reproduce fully the engine environment around the can combustor. Now let's have a look at some results. Among a large number of monitoring devices, two cameras are looking at the flames. In particular, here we see in this schematic first camera that it's recording the first stage flame looking against the flow, and the second camera here that is recording the second stage flame and the corresponding images in these two rows here. So in this top row we see the images from the first stage flame, and the second stage flame is shown down here, and here we recorded the images while actually validating exactly this maneuver of taking away fuel from the first stage, tuning then the auto ignition time in the second stage, flame stability on the first stage, so that one could accommodate more and more hydrogen when going in this series of measurement points from left to right. So full temperature can be achieved until 70% hydrogen, and one can go also farther. However, after a certain level, flame propagation starts to play some role also on the second stage, and then it's necessary to reduce the temperature also on the second stage a bit. So the key, these four diagrams are representing the most interesting, I would say, parameters associated with this natural gas hydrogen sweep. On the top left, we see here the exit temperature of the system, as said, that can be fully maintained at H-class levels all the way until 70%, and then a certain reduction when auto-ignition and propagation effects are combined. All this happens through this maneuver, as said, where the sequential burner inlet temperature is tuned to keep the auto-ignition time and the flame stability. On the right chart here, we see the effect on the emissions, in particular CO2 with the black squares that it's dropping down when increasing hydrogen on the x-axis, of course, as expected. We see the first stage NOx with these orange dots that it's first decreasing because of the lower and lower flame temperature in the first stage, but then picking up strongly when larger amounts of hydrogen are coming. However, this is not translated into such an extreme NOx effect on the second stage, because less and less fuel is put on the first stage when going up with the amounts of hydrogen, and here the NOx goes even further down, but mainly because the flame temperature of the second stage is also going down, as shown in this chart here. Also, very important parameters on the bottom left chart here, the maximum metal temperature that have to always stay away from this critical level to ensure full lifetime of the parts, and the thermoacoustic here on the bottom right panel, which we see are close to zero until some 20-30%. At 30% hydrogen increase a bit, but still very far away from the limit that is the 100% scale here. So it's possible, and this is, I think, a very big asset of this system. It's possible to tune this parameter to have a thermoacoustic free operation through the whole sweep between natural gas and hydrogen. Now, before getting actually to toward the conclusion of this presentation, I thought it would be interesting just to have a replay of a test shown a little bit, of course, faster than what would be in the reality. So here we see on the top panel the video of the first stage running and starting with 10% hydrogen in the fuel and the corresponding second stage here. And In the chart here, the real data coming out from the rig and the power as tuned as set on the first stage, which is going down, of course, as set here, while increasing the hydrogen on the second stage. This goes up to compensate this power missing on the first stage and keeping then the same reactivity. And here the total power that is then as a result maintained pretty much constant at H class levels on the overall system. And as shown before, this we'll see until 70% autoignition dominated flame on the second stage, no need to get any compromise, and then after 70% the power on the sequential burner needs also a certain reduction on today's hardware to keep the flame stability on the second stage as well, and then a certain loss on the power is to be taken again with today's hardware. Now getting into the outlook, we have seen in this short overview that the GT36 sequential combustion is offering an intrinsic advantage for fuel flexibility and in particular then exploitable for hydrogen. The standard GT36 combustion system was tested in a high pressure rig, demonstrating its suitability as a technology enabler for covering the full sweep, full range of natural gas and hydrogen blends. Now we are fully devoted into optimizing the hard and operation concept and the system for a system targeting 100% hydrogen operation and increased performance with the high hydrogen end, so to recover at least part of this power loss and get also the optimization on the 100%. And this is done also thanks to the valuable inputs and studies done within the NCCS, and also starting from last year the so-called Flex4H2 project, which is EU and Swiss founded initiative aiming at the development of a combustion system capable of 100% hydrogen combustion at H class conditions. Well, with this, I'm actually at the end of this overview, and I hope you found this interesting. Thanks for attending this, and please do not hesitate now if we have still a bit of time to pose any questions on any of the topics.